Are you very excited about this? We're very excited. We're very delighted about the appearance of our first guest. This next gentleman requires no introduction. For the first time on our program, ladies and gentlemen, please say hello to one of my favorite actors, Sean Connery. Jetpacks.
I just came from Europe.
That was very thrilling. Was that? Did you enjoy that?
Well, my voice is about two tones higher, but
a snug fit, eh?
Yeah.
You didn't get that jetpack at the like electronics store around the corner, did you?
Yeah, Charlie gave it to me.
That I can't get over what an impression that makes when you just drop down there in that cloud of smoke. Hmm? How you doing?
Well, I'm doing fine. I'm really here to sort of quell these rumors about my death.
Oh, really? Have there been rumors that you have passed away?
Yeah, something like that.
I'm sorry to hear that.
Yeah, well, I was too until I heard that it's good luck in the Orient to consider that you, when they say you've been announced dead and you're still alive, it means longevity.
Oh, well, good. Congratulations, then.
No, what happened, basically, it's a bit of a farce, like most things. A dear friend of mine, James Hunt, the racing driver, he died.
World champion.
Yeah, he lived near me in Marbella. And it was picked up as James Bond. And then it went on to the press. And then it was picked up in Japan the same day that the governor, ex-governor of Texas,
John Connolly. Yeah.
But then, of course, John Connolly is like Sean Connery in Japanese. This is absolute gospel. And then it went to France and Spain, and people were phoning up all over. And, you know, very few people ever know where I am, even me, you know. And anyway, that was the sort of finale of that one.
And you say very few people ever really know where you are, and you say you're not sure. But really, where are you? Where does a guy like you hang around? Where you live in Spain most of the time?
Well, I was up there for 20 minutes. In fact, I live in the Bahamas, and sometimes in Spain, and sometimes in Monte Carlo, and sometimes in Los Angeles, and sometimes where I'm working, wherever that is.
You're a very, very lucky man.
How am I supposed to read that?
Well, no, I'm just saying...
This is the first time we've met.
Well, it's... It's just that you seem to cut a grand figure of glamour, and it's nice that you can live that way as well.
Well, thank you.
Yeah. I don't know what I'm talking about either. Don't worry about it.
No, one of the other points I wanted to clarify, I was also had a serious throat disorder of cancer, which obviously is not true, and I wouldn't be able to speak, et cetera, which was something else that was picked up by the media, started in this town, and went round the world. Well, needless to say, I came here to be in living color with you.
Thank you.
So I'm obviously okay.
So you have... So you had some sort of minor throat problem, but it was certainly not as dire as was reported.
No.
Yeah.
No, not at all.
This is something you've had before, some kind of... Yeah. Because I know there was a time when you were communicating, they told you to rest your voice.
Yeah, that's right. I put a note saying, sorry, I cannot speak. I have a throat problem. Uh-huh. And everybody would say, why? What's wrong? so I would write down, say, I cannot speak, just, you know. So they'd take the paper and they would write it down, and I would have to write, I can write, you know, and I'm not deaf.
Yeah.
Or they spoke loud.
Yeah.
Very loud.
Well, all of this is good news, and you, you know, forgive me again, but you look terrific.
Thank you.
Yeah. You know what, in thinking about films of yours that I have seen and enjoyed, The Man Who Would Be King, what a great movie.
Yeah.
Fine.
Thank you. Yeah. Well, you talk about patience, John Huston waited, 39 years to make the movie.
Mm-hmm.
And we had a lot of fun, Michael Caine and myself, and we shot it in Morocco, which is incidentally where I met my wife, so lucky twice, very good.
Yeah.
But the thing about Morocco that's so different is that, for example, one day I was driving from Marrakesh miles to a location every day, sitting on this ribbon of a road, and it was directly into the sun. And I was going about, I don't know, an hour, sitting, just the driver and me. And suddenly, on the left side of the road there appeared a little black dot that got bigger and bigger. As I got closer, I realized it was an old man carrying a bundle of sticks. Oh, 2 meters high, just at a very strange pace with a teapot on his belt. I said, well, what's he doing? And the driver said, oh, well, from this area here, they get these special twigs and they use it for charcoal, for drawing. They've done it for hundreds of years. And I said, well, where would he come from? I mean, I can't see anything. He said, well, they maybe came from the mountains there. Mountains were miles away. I said, well, you mean he's what? Where's he going? I said, he's going to Marrakesh to sell it. I said, oh, really? So, anyway, I go to the location, we shoot, I'm coming back at night, and I'm a little tired, and on the same road, I suddenly see, on the right-hand side, this dot appearing again, and I get closer, and it's the old guy. So I said, pull in, and ask him if he wants a lift. He's, you know, we're going to Marrakesh. Yeah, that's sure. Where he's going. I said, yeah. So he's okay, stop the car. So he goes back, and I'm watching in the mirror what he's doing, and he goes up and he starts talking, and the old guy says, so I get out of the car and I say, come on, what's the problem? You know, does he want a lift or doesn't he want a lift? I mean, we'll have him there in 20 minutes from here. And he says, well, his problem is he doesn't know what he's going to do with the time that he's going to save.
Schedule.
Yeah. And it's been 5 days getting there.
What would he do with all that leisure time?
Absolutely.
What, speaking of leisure time, when you were shooting the movie, you and Michael Caine are and were friends.
Oh, yeah.
And was there any period of recreation for you? Could you do anything there, or was it just desolation?
Well, we were coming back from one village in the mountains, miles from anywhere, and we wanted to stop off and have a drink, and then there was some really good music because they're great musicians in Morocco, and it's difficult to get a drink because not most of the Muslims don't drink. Mm-hmm. But anyway, we found the one place where you could have something, and it was great music, but suddenly we looked around, there were no women. So I said to Michael, do you mind if I dance with your driver, because he's prettier than mine? It's absolutely true.
Too much time in the desert. I can't tell you what a thrill it is to have you here, and especially to have you here and see that you're in great shape and there's nothing wrong with you, and it's a real treat for us to have you drop by. Thank you very much.